Good evening. I'm glad that you've set this time aside that we can look at God's Word together, and I hope that you would find this very informative. And we look forward tonight as we bring God's Word to you. But before we go any further, let us pause for a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for this day that You have allowed us to see. Lord, we look at our nation and we see that it's in a lot of trouble. It's heartbreaking to see all these things happening. But Lord, we realize that man is not going to be able to fix it. Only You, if You intervene, You can put a stop to this, and we can get back to being more civilized than what we've been lately. We ask that You be with those that are sick, those that are hurting, those that are suffering, that's calling out to You. Lord, we ask that You lay Your hand upon them and encourage them. Watch over us and guide us. For these things we ask in Christ's name, amen. One of the great teachings in the Scriptures is the doctrine of the security of the believer. It's found in many books in the Bible. The teaching of the security believer is also a controversial, and a lot of people has problems with it. But if we look carefully at the Scriptures, one would have a hard time making a case against the doctrine of the security of believer. Many Christians out there tonight has never fully enjoyed their salvation. And the reason why, they are afraid they're going to lose their salvation. It's a terrible thing that many people believe that they can lose their salvation. So they're never happy. They seem like they've always tensed up. They can never enjoy their salvation. They believe if one slips up, they're lost again. And they must go through the same thing that they went before in order to go to heaven. They got to get saved again. The way they believe. Some people, I would say, have been saved 100 times. And it's a terrible shame that so many Christian people believe that they can lose their salvation. And because of that, I don't think they can really enjoy and appreciate the salvation that the Lord offers to anyone who calls upon His name. The devil and those who work for him, they come into the church, and through false teaching, they create confusion among so many. And because of that, a lot of people just give up trying to live for the Lord, because they believe that you cannot sin no more. And it's very difficult when you believe that, and you believe that you can lose your salvation and trying to live for the Lord at the same time. It's very, very difficult. I knew a man that had gotten saved. He was an older man. And a lot of his friends would tell him, "Now you know that you can't do this no more, because if you do, you're lost again." And he was struggling with his walk with the Lord. He was constantly going to the altar. And he couldn't take it no more. It was driving him crazy. And he shot himself. Now his friends believe that he went to hell because of that. He was confused. But I remember the night that he got saved. So the devil tries his best to trip us up, to create confusion about this teaching here in the Bible. God wants His people happy. He don't want them wondering if they're going to lose their salvation. He don't want them to think that he can't keep them saved. So let's look at this great teaching, and I hope that it will ease any doubts that you may have concerning losing your salvation. If you believe God's word, then you should be able to trust God. That's the thing that I think you need to hold on to. If you believe God, then you ought to be able to trust God. Here in the Gospel of John, I want to begin reading in chapter 10, verse 27. Now, Jesus is talking here. And he says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father who gave them to me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one." This chapter here is one of many that can answer the question, can we lose our salvation? Keep in mind here, now Jesus in this whole chapter is doing most of the talking. Our salvation is secure by the finished work that Jesus did, and it took place at Calvary. Think about that. He took my place. He bore my pain. And I received a pardon. When Jesus died on the cross for me and the forgiveness of my sins, he's able to keep me saved. And I don't have to go around wondering if I'm going to lose my salvation. That's a great burden to be lifted. But there's some out there tonight, you are still worried that you may do something wrong and you lose your salvation. I hope that you pay close attention to those words that I read tonight. They are very important. It's an awful thing to live in a state of fear that you're going to lose your salvation. And I hope tonight that through God's word and through the work of the Holy Spirit, you won't have to worry about that no more. There are four things I want us to investigate tonight dealing with this doctrine of eternal security of the believer. There's four things that I think will help you understand this. It has helped me. Salvation is offered to everyone through faith in Christ. All of us, probably, if you've been in church most of your life, you know that verse, John 3:16. That's the whole Bible wrapped up in one verse. And Jesus was talking to a religious fella. And here is where this verse comes from. It's offered to everybody through faith in Christ. Another thing I'd like for you to keep in mind is this. Regardless of your past, Jesus still can save you. How many people has been told you can't go to heaven? Why is that? Because you've been married 2 times. You can't go. You might as well not even go to church. It's not going to do you no good. My father told me of a story of a man that he knew. And one day he had a little shop that he would go and do some work at. And he was closing up his building, and this man who lived right there at his place of business came by, and they was talking. And this man rode by and blew the horn, and he waved at him, and he told my father, he said, Carl, that man can't go to heaven. He said, why? Well, he's got two living wives. My father looked at him. He said, Matthew, he said, have you ever looked on a woman and lusted? I'm not talking about me, I'm talking about him. You see, a lot of people has been told they couldn't go to heaven because of their past. They might have committed a great crime. They might have robbed a bank, robbed a store. They might have even murdered somebody. But I read the Bible through several times. And one of the great verses in the Bible, it's a part of a verse. It says, Jesus cleanses from all sin. That sort of takes care of those things, don't it? He cleanses from all sin. So regardless of where you are, regardless of your past, Jesus still can save you because he offers salvation to anyone who comes to him through faith. It don't matter how far you've been in sin. It doesn't matter how deep you've gone. Christ's love is deeper than your sin. He loves you. He wants to save you. He wants you to be in heaven one day with him. And some people may think, I can't ever get saved because of how dirty and rotten my sins had been. The enemy wants you to believe God's word is not true. Now we find this early in the scriptures, there in Genesis. There was Adam and Eve in the garden, had everything that they ever would ever need right there in the garden. Every day in the evening, cool of the day, God will come and talk with them. That had been a glorious time for Adam and Eve. They had it made, folks. And one day, the serpent came around. And the serpent, this is what he said. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. Now remember, God told both of them that the day that they partake of this tree, they will die. But she believed the serpent. He was smart. He was the smartest being God ever created. And he said it in such a way that she believed him. The enemy wants you to believe God's word is not true. And how many people have stood in classes and told people that you can lose your salvation? Now, God doesn't lie, but men do. And regardless of your doubts about God's word, it's still true. You may say, I don't believe it. It doesn't matter. God's word is true. I don't believe all this. It doesn't matter. I was at the doctor's office one day in Moore County. I was talking to a professor at UNC. Nice fella. Had a good conversation. And he asked me, he said, what all do you do? And I told him that I was a minister, but also worked an outside job. And he started at that moment making fun of me. He said, I don't think too much of a religion that has a talking snake. I said, oh, you don't? He said, no. I said, what you going to do about Polly wants a cracker? If he'd have had a gun, I believe he would have shot me. I told him, I said, Mr. Professor, I'm sure you're a smart feller, but I believe I would spend a little more of my time reading God's Word than those books that you're reading. But regardless of your doubts about God's Word, it's true. Some reasons why we should believe God's Word. Because of what has been prophesied in the Bible. Now, some people wants to argue about God's Word being true. But there are some things in the Bible that has been predicted it was going to happen. In the book of Daniel, Daniel's talking that towards the end, the latter days, that man's knowledge would increase. Well, that certainly has happened. Look at the computers, look at the airplanes, the trains. Look at where we are now when Daniel made that statement. God's word is true. He said that men's knowledge would increase in the latter days. And then there was a man named Cyrus that was spoken about 150 years before he was born. And then there was Israel. Because of their rebellion, they're turning away from God, just like America is doing. God got fed up with it. And the Babylonians came and took them away. And later on, they rebelled again. And this time, the nation of Israel didn't exist no more. For 2,500 years, there was no country named Israel. But God said in the book of Ezekiel that they would come back to life again. 2,500 years later, in May of 1948, guess what happened? Israel became a nation again. After 2,500 years. Now that's just some of the things. And then in 70 AD, Titus came, burnt the temple, destroyed the temple. And Jesus had predicted about 40 years before that one day this temple would be destroyed. And that not one stone would be left on top of another. But those Roman soldiers seen all that gold and silver in that temple. And they began to take their picks and go in there. And historians said not one stone was left on top of another. They was looking for the gold and the silver that had melted in between those blocks. Now that's just some of the reasons why we should believe God's word. Some reasons why we should trust God's word is because we need to practice it. When we practice God's word, it makes a big difference in our life. The second thing, the good shepherd claims us as his own. In verse 27, I want you to listen. Now, listen to carefully to these words. Now, I said that the good shepherd claims us as his own. Listen to what it says in verse 27. My sheep. That's ownership. They're his. They belong to him. My sheep. If you've got a dog, you tell everybody, that's my dog. That's my dog. You own that dog. And Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. That's a relationship. That sounds like a relationship. Do you have one with him? Is he your shepherd? He is mine. I do have a relationship with him. It's established at our new birth. When you and I put our faith in Christ, we become his children. Now here's something, another verse I want to read to you. It's in Romans chapter 8, verse 16. Again, he identifies us as His. Listen to what it says, Romans 8:16. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. We're His children. You can't change that. And that is what makes me feel comfortable that I'm His. I'll always be His. We are the sons and daughters of our parents. It was established at birth. I can lie. I can say that my father is not my father. But a simple blood test will prove that my father was my father. It was established at birth. I am the son of Carl and Darce Marie. It was established at birth. I'm one of God's children because it was established in my new birth. He says, my sheep recognize His voice. That's proof of our relationship. We recognize His voice. Folks, I'm trying to tell you that we are His children and that He will never, ever abandon us. We belong to Him. It's a familiar voice, and a stranger they will not follow. Most of you may have read books by Warren Wiersbe, terrific writer. They used to call him the Bee Man, because just about every book that he wrote would be faithful, be happy. He was called the Bee Man. And he wrote a book one time, and he had went to Israel to get some background on this book that he was beginning to write. And he had noticed that these sheep would come down with their shepherd to get water. And they'd be all mixed in together, hundreds of sheep. When the shepherd was ready to leave and go somewhere else, he would get up on a hill and he would holler. And all of his sheep would come out and follow him. He thought that was amazing because there was hundreds of sheep there, hundreds of them. So Warren Wiersbe asked one of these shepherds, he said, can I try that? And the shepherd, he said, got the laughing at him. He said, yeah, be my guest. So he gets up on the hill. He had went over that sound, that voice. He had it down pat, and he got up there and he hollered the same thing that that shepherd had told him that's what he does. And when he done that, the sheep scattered. They run till they could find their shepherd. A stranger they will not follow. It is their favorite voice that they love to hear. You know, the 23rd Psalm is a great, great chapter about the shepherd and the sheep. And when you read it, you'll see that there's no want. There's food all around them. They have refreshing water. And the great thing is there was no fear around them. That shepherd would go out in front of them looking for those serpents that could be on the ground. He cared for his sheep. There's another truth that makes me feel eternally secure. Not only does he claim us as his, the good shepherd guards us as his own. He looks after us. The security of the believer is demonstrated by his power. Now, folks, we really, really need to pay attention to this. In verse 29, I want to read it. Now, pay attention to these words. My Father, who gave them to me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. Sounds pretty secure to me, doesn't it, you? The security of the believer is demonstrated by his power. He says no one can take his sheep from him. No one. Now, folks, I don't know how you can explain that any better. He said no one can do it. If God created this world, if he pitched the stars up into space, said go here but don't go no farther, if God can do that, don't you think he can keep you? I do. He takes care of us. And no one, not even yourself, because I know some of you out there are thinking, well, I can do it. No, you can't. You need to read verse 29 again. I had a funeral a long time ago. And I was, the lady that had died, she was one of those that was worried about her salvation. She got saved when she was 17 years old. And she had drifted way, way, way away. She was dying. And we talked. And I began to explain to her about salvation. She said, well, I can take myself out, can't you? I said, no, you can't do it. I said, it's like this. I said, it's like joining the mafia. Once you get in, you ain't getting out. And that's good. Because she was counted as a sheep into his fold. We are now forever the sheep of his pastor. Now, from time to time, we have those that gets careless in the way that they live. They get out there in the world again. Have you ever seen the picture of Jesus carrying a sheep on his shoulder? Now, you may not understand about the background of that, but I do. That sheep that he was carrying on his back couldn't walk because the shepherd personally broke his leg. Yeah, broke his leg. By breaking his leg, that sheep will never stray again. He found protection in the fold. There's a lot of Christians walking around with broken legs spiritually because they kept wandering away and God said, I've had enough. Oh, I'm going to tell you, he takes care of us. Sometime he has to hurt us. The security of the believer is demonstrated by his patience. He's got plenty of patience. The security of the believer is demonstrated by his patience for the simple fact is this. He's still working on us. He's like a sculptor chiseling away on a huge rock, getting the rough edges off, and one day that rock will be beautiful. He's constantly working with us. And then lastly, the good shepherd gives us eternal life. You can't kill eternal life. What is the definition of eternal life? I want to tell you something. That right there was one of the greatest eye openings I've ever had. I was working with a guy named Ricky Dawkins. He's in heaven now. I preached his funeral. And we was arguing one time about losing your salvation. He said, Carl, it's impossible. You can't do it. And he quoted John 3:16. I went home that day and went over to my father's house, and he's a minister, and we was talking, and I was telling him, I said, you know, this crazy guy was telling me you can't lose your salvation. My father had a way of getting the attention. He said, well, you idiot, how did you address him? And I told him, He says, "Son, can you quote John 3:16?" I said, "Yes." And I did. He said, "Will you give me the definition of eternal life?" I said, "It's forever." He said, "Case closed." That was the greatest eye-opening I've ever had. But what is your definition of eternal life? Does it mean something totally different? You have it as long as you don't sin. Now, if you want to struggle like that, you got my permission. But if you look at God's words and you look at them closely, you will find out that you're in a mess. Words have meaning, and we need to understand them. Words give messages to reveal truth. I asked you again, what is your definition of eternal life? Does it mean that you have it as long as you don't sin? Well, how's that working out to you? I bet that's not doing too good, is it? Folks, you can't work your way into heaven, and there's nothing you can do to gain eternal life. Being a good person isn't good enough. Being baptized 100 times, you may be baptized so much that you know every tadpole in the pond, but that won't get you into heaven. It's a relationship with Christ. Do you have that? Have there ever been a time that you've asked Jesus to come into your life and be your Lord, your shepherd, and your master? Have you ever done that? Well, if you haven't, you're still in your sins and in need of a Savior. Being a member of a church isn't the answer either. We must confess that we are a sinner in need of a Savior, and that you need to trust Jesus and Him alone, and He will give you eternal life. And you will be secured for now and throughout eternity. Father, we thank you for your word and the truth we find in it. Lord, I just hope tonight, if there's anybody out there who has been struggling with this for a long time, that it has eased that burden. For we ask it in Christ's name. Amen.